In this video, I would like to explain how to give good and effective presentations. I've given this talk a couple of times to a live audience, which is unfortunately not possible at the moment. That's why I thought it might be a good idea to record this talk on video. As said, so all the tips and hints and advice that I give is was intended to be used for live presentations, but I think at least some or the larger portion of the tips might be also useful for video presentations like this or presentations via video conferencing system like Zoom or WebEx. So at first, a short motivation. Why would you give a talk? Why would you present something? Of course, if you are in a university, you attend seminars and you sometimes have to give presentations there. If you are a student, you might also apply for a stipend or for a grant, so you need to give a presentation there. And then later on, you work as a researcher, you go to conferences to present your work there. And so for me, maybe one of the most impressive presentations that I have ever given is a Science Slam. If you don't know what a Science Slam is, you usually have something like 5 to 10 minutes to explain your field of research to a larger audience. And so here it was in a theater, Friday evening, about 500 to 600 people in the room. And it's maybe a bit difficult to see on the picture. It was, I think, a couple of days after Leonard Nimoy died. And so the whole audience is doing this Star Trek salute to honor him. And yeah, so for me, with this quite large audience, a very impressive presentation about my field of research in a 10-minute very funny talk. So this said, a little disclaimer. So I'm not a presentation trainer, I'm an engineer, so everything that I tell here is also just my more or less personal point of view, what I would like to advise as an engineer. So what I'm trying to explain is I've tried to structure the talk into four parts: how to reach your audience, then if you give a presentation, what is a good structure for this presentation. Usually you would prepare some slides like these ones here, so how to create useful slides. And if you are an engineer, or if you are a mathematician, or if you do natural sciences or physics, you often want to visualize data. So I also want to cover this a little bit, because it's quite important in this fields of research. So first part, how to reach your audience. There are some basic principles. The most important one is you should know your audience. This is easier said than done. But you should know what kind of people you are giving your talk to, because you should know their previous knowledge. This is very important for selecting the information that you want to talk about and the structure of your presentation. And the second thing is you should concentrate on important things. Why? Because you usually have a limited amount of time. Yeah. So don't tell them stuff that they already know. Don't tell them stuff that is unimportant. Try to concentrate on important stuff. What helps the audience listen to you is if you try to tell a story at least. Yeah, so try to put it into something that is nice to listen to, and also try to be yourself. There is this nice quote from Oscar Wilde, yeah, because everyone else's role is already taken. And some general do's is do visualize. You know, the saying, a picture says 1,000 words. You can sometimes more, sometimes less, at least try to be a little funny, because this cheers people up and also helps them to listen to you. You should motivate your audience why it is important what you're talking about. And you should also, even if especially if it's a longer talk, try to summarize in between a little bit what you already captured and what will come. And especially important on conferences, you should keep on time. Because there's limited amount of time, and the time that you are over, you're stealing from other persons that also want to tell something to a larger audience. Then some very general advice is speak without notes. We will come to this point back later. There is maybe some exception for this if you are a mathematician and if you talk about very complicated mathematical formulas, then you might want to have some written support just for these formulas, but not for your talk in general. Because to be honest, it's just boring to listen to someone who just reads notes. There are some other ways to annoy your audience. If you speak too quiet, it will be very difficult to listen to you. Also, if you speak too loud, it will cause pain in the ears of your audience. The same is if you speak too fast or too slow. I'm usually a little too fast, but also if you're very slow and if you really think about very long about each word, then it's also very, very boring or very annoying for your audience. The same is if you mumble, if you mumble, then it's also difficult to listen to you. One general advice, I mean, you don't see me here, this is especially important for live talks. You should not focus on the projection screen, but you should always, or at least try to look at the audience. Because then you can see the reactions of the audience and don't, if you use a laser pointer, which is good to highlight something on the screen, like I use my mouse pointer here, don't flash this laser pointer constantly. Use it if you want to highlight something, but don't leave it on all the time flashing around in the room. And even if you are, if you might be unprepared for a presentation, for a talk, you should not give this impression to the audience. For live sessions, for live presentations, be appropriately dressed. It's of course not so important if you. I would not say that I'm sitting here in my pajama right now. I'm still properly dressed, but it's not so important for a video talk like this, and also for a Zoom meeting. Only the upper part of the body should be properly dressed, and use nice body language. Don't put your arms in front of you. Don't look angry. This will also annoy your audience a little bit. Okay, and there is some advice if you are usually someone that maybe speaks a little too quiet. If you know someone in the audience, and we usually do this for our student presentations at student conferences, some student sitting in the last row will get a sign like this, and if he or she sitting in the last row has problems in understanding the speaker in front, he or she will raise this sign so that the speaker sees this sign and then knows, okay, I have to speak a little louder, otherwise people in the audience will have problems listening to me and understanding me properly. Okay, so let's come to the structure of the presentation. And some general advice for the structure is your audience should know the direction. Your audience should somehow know what your talk is about. So you should somehow explain, it's a little bit like for a journey. Where do we start? Yeah, what do we begin with? What does the audience maybe already know? And where we want to go? What is our goal? Where do we want to end? And so then, what is the path from the start to this goal? This is what should be kind of clear to your audience, and that you want to explain with your structure. So, a good structure for an engineering or for a scientific talk like this, or like a general scientific engineering talk, is you usually have some introduction, then you talk about some fundamentals, about the state of the art, then you maybe have done some experiments. You maybe have done some simulations or some calculations. You compare them, show your results, discuss them, and at the end there will be some conclusion. This is in general, it's a good structure, but if you show this, it is too generic because 80% of the presentations at the talks at scientific conferences will have more or less this structure. So it should be a bit more detailed, a bit more precise. So I come from electromagnetic compatibility. So if I give a talk, I would introduce the audience not something general, but I would give an introduction to electromagnetic compatibility. Then I would show some fundamentals of a measurement environment that I work with, which is reverberation chambers. I have done some experiments with shielded cables. I have done some simulations using a certain software, and then I compare some certain results. You see, it's the same structure as before, but now people would at least have a little more precise idea of what you're trying to talk about. If you plan for the time range of your presentation, a good rule of thumb is something like 1 to 2 minutes per slide. And so then you can see if you have just, let's say, 2 minutes or 5 minutes or maybe something like 10 minutes, it's only advertising. You can only show a couple of slides. You cannot really give deep insight into a topic. If you have something like 20 minutes, which is the usual duration that you have during a seminar, during a scientific presentation, you can already deliver some information. But yeah, to be honest, it's also more, if you go to a conference and give a talk, there is also more advertisement. Look, I have done this and this. If you want to know more information, please take a look at my paper. It might be very interesting for you, but you cannot, you write a paper about what you have done over half a year. Of course, you cannot show everything that you have done in half a year in just a 20-minute presentation. And only with really longer durations, you could really try to give deep insight into a topic as you would do in a lecture or some longer talk. But then also, it might be very hard for your audience to listen to you over this long period of time without any break in between and so on. Okay. Some more ways to annoy your audience. You should not have, or you should not present, a too detailed structure. No structure with, let's say, 10 points, because no one will be able to remember these 10 points. You should also not spend too much time in explaining the structure and the outline of your presentation, because it will follow later on what you are talking about. And if you talk about a scientific topic, it's not a diary. So even if you have done measurements and if you have done simulations and so on, you should not talk about this in chronological order. Yeah, in the first week I have done this, in the second week I've done this. No, it's important on what is the scientific outcome, what is the knowledge that you gained in your work. This is what your audience is interested in, and not your diary, not your research diary, what you have done in the first week and second week. When explaining your structure or when you're giving your talk, you should also not directly jump into the topic. As said, you should give an introduction, you should give a motivation, and you should have a well-defined goal. And there should be also a more or less clear sequence of slides. It should not be very puzzling and chaotic, because this is also difficult to understand and it will confuse your audience. There's a nice comic by Randall Munroe that explains this. I will not read this comic here. If you like, you can just stop this video for a second and read this and think about it. Okay, so I will go on and tell you something about how to create useful slides. First thing that you should remember is the slides, they are just a tool. They can be quite important, but they are not the most important thing. Your presentation is what matters. Yeah, so the slides are just a tool for you to deliver a good presentation. But even with very, very bad slides, one can give a good presentation. And even with almost perfect slides, one can give a very bad presentation. So good slides are not everything. The most common mistake, in my point of view, is that people put too much text on the slides. The reason maybe for this is they want to have some help when they give their presentation, so that they have some text maybe to read, maybe some information what they would like to talk about. So again, some example from my field of research, electromagnetic compatibility. I've given here the very general definition of what electromagnetic compatibility is, and then there is some sentence that explains the different coupling phenomena. And you could try to explain your audience with the help of this slide what electromagnetic compatibility is and what it means. But the problem is, what will people do if they look at this slide? They will read this text and this text, and they can read it much faster as you are explaining it. And so after half of the time when you are still explaining your slide, the audience will be finished with reading the text here, and then they said, okay, I've understand what the slide is all about, and then they will start to look around, look out of the window, check the messages on their cell phone, and so on and so on, and will not listen to you anymore. So this is what will happen. Yeah, people will read the slide instead of listening to you. So this is what you want to avoid. And how to avoid it? Don't put so much text on the slides. So a better slide would look like this. It would say, okay, electromagnetic compatibility consists of immunity and emission, and there are different coupling paths. And now you could explain, yeah, electromagnetic compatibility means that devices will satisfactorily work in some electromagnetic environment, that they will not be disturbed by other devices in this environment. This is what we call immunity. And at the same time, that they do not radiate electromagnetic fields into their surrounding. And this is what we call emission. And so there are different coupling paths between these devices. It can be via cables. This is what we would call conductive coupling. And it can be over electric fields and so on and so on. You understand the principle. There are less words now. They still help you in knowing what you would like to tell about the slide, but there is no text for your audience to read. So the audience has to listen to you to understand what this is all about. Yeah? And this is what makes a good presentation. I mean, otherwise the audience could also just read a book. And so this would be better. How to make it even better would look like this. Use a picture instead. Use visualization. Have a nice schematic like this. Yeah, so EMC means we have different devices, they work in some electromagnetic environment, they could work or they could interfere with each other. So we would say there one device is a source, another device is a victim, and there are different coupling paths between these devices, working over radiating fields, working over cables, working over magnetic fields, working over electric fields, and so on and so on. And then it's much more interesting for the audience to listen to you. So some further advice. Usually I would suggest to use one main message per slide. Yeah? Don't put too much information on one slide. Put only one main message per slide. Use short headwords only. There is this 1-6-6 rule. So on one slide, there should be just 6-6 headwords, and each headword should only consist of a maximum of 6 words, something like this. Again, just don't too much text that people can read. A plain design helps to have nice and plain slides. Try to use clear contrast. Try to use a dark font on a white background, or on a maybe light gray background, something like this, or use a very bright font on a very dark background. Of course, the problem is if you have a very dark background, or a black background, it maybe looks good, but it's horrible for printing. And I know some people who make fun of this because they know that the audience will print the slides. And so they have on their very last slide, they always have an Amazon affiliate link. If you need to buy toner for your printer, for your laser printer, please do it here. Because then if you print my slides, I will earn like a couple of cents because you need to buy this new toner. Use large font size. Yeah, this is the same. If you speak too quiet, no one will be able to listen to you. If you use a font that is too small, then also people sitting in the last row will have problems in reading the text or reading the words on your slides. And if you use different colors, which is usually good, you should have a meaningful way. So here, for everything that is good, I use this green. For everything that is bad, I use this red, like alert. And for unimportant stuff, I use this light gray. Another good advice is to number your slides. Why? Because people then can ask specific questions related to a certain slide, and they don't have to ask later on, like, can you show this slide again where we had this strange formula or this strange picture on the left side? They can just ask, okay, can you show slide 23 again, because I have a question related to this. And especially for larger conferences, it's good to have a meaningful header and footer. You can see I have this nice header here where you can see, okay, we have already covered this part, and now we are somewhere in the middle of this part, and this will still follow. And in the footer, I always have my slide number here, and I have the title of this presentation. Of course, here in this video recording, it does not make too much sense, because you will have this title of the presentation somewhere around in this video window if you look at this on YouTube, for example. But if you go to a larger conference, and hopefully we will have such larger conferences again in the future, there are several sessions in parallel, and people will hop from session to session, and sometimes they will later on, even if you have already started your presentation and your title slide, where your first slide where the title is shown is not visible anymore and your name is not visible anymore, they still want to know, okay, am I in the right room listening? Am I listening to the right presentation? So it's always good to have your title and maybe also your name, the title of your of the presentation on your name on every slide. So that people know, okay, even if there are very many sessions and talks in parallel, I'm listening to the right presentation. Still, the information here in this footer is sometimes difficult to see. You all know this. If you have a person sitting in front of you which has a very large hat or a strange hairdress, then it's sometimes so. This part here can be sometimes difficult to see. Usually you can nicely see this, and you can always perfectly see this here on top. So this is the part that is always nicely visible. So please put important information here, and this is don't put too much information here in the footer. Some more ways to annoy your audience: don't have typos on your slides, of course. Don't use very complicated formulas without any reason. Of course, if you give an engineering talk, if you give a talk about some mathematical topic, you will and you need to have some formulas, but choose them wisely. If you use formulas, use consistent notation. Don't use sometimes this symbol and on the next slide another symbol, because this confuses your audience. And what also confuses your audience is if you use unknown abbreviations. I would usually suggest to use a plain font like this, a sans serif font, a font without serifs. If you use like a font like this Times New Roman, which is a serif font, yeah, serifs are these small markings here on the letters. They help our eye to catch this line. It is nice if you have long text like in a newspaper or in some article, but as said, on slides you don't have long text. And usually this Times New Roman or fonts like this, they look bad on a projector because these serifs only consist of a few pixels, and this makes the font look a little blurry and fuzzy, and this plain font looks much better. I would also usually suggest to don't use fancy animations between slides, because it's also puzzling and confusing and taking attention away from the main message that you would like to tell to your audience. And it's also not nice to use too many different colors. I remember that I have seen at some conference a presentation where the logo of the university of the college was animated, and it, to be honest, it distracted me so much that every 5 or 10 seconds or so this logo here would change its color. And I have not understood why people would ever use a template where their university logo would change the color like every few seconds. It's very distracting. Okay, so we come to the three contradicting tasks of slides, and the only task for slides like this is they should visualize your spoken word. Yeah, they should help your reader to understand what you're trying to talk about. Still, Some people also use slides as a documentation of their talk. Put more information on the slides as would be necessary because they know, okay, people will use these slides even if they did not attend the talk to understand what you're talking about and maybe read this later on and so on. And some people, unfortunately, also sometimes use their slides as a manuscript, as a help for them, for the speaker. Instead of some written notes. So slides, as said, they should only fulfill this task. If you really need a documentation of your talk, you should prepare a handout if it's really necessary. And if you need to have some small notes, as said, which is not a problem, but don't use a full written script, just some notes. You can also use a second screen sometimes. Yeah, you can have your computer and on one screen it's showing the projection and on the other screen you have some small notes to support you during your presentation. But then don't look at these notes all the time. Look into your audience, sometimes look at the projector if it's projecting the right stuff, but don't look at these notes all the time. Some useful software, we all know PowerPoint, it's quasi standard. There are other nice tools. Prezi is a website where you can do presentations a little bit like a mind map. So you have a large map, you can put some information there and put some information there and put some information there, and then you like zoom in and out during your presentation. Can be quite nice and interesting for the audience. I do all my presentations in LaTeX because you can separate content from style. And there are other nice online tools like the SlideWiki where you can create website, where you can create presentations just like a website in your browser, and also do this in collaboration with other persons, which is much easier than if you would do this in PowerPoint and if you would all the time send your PowerPoint presentations back and forth via email ping pong. But PowerPoint, again, nice schematic or comic from Randall Munroe. I will not comment on this. You can think about this yourself. Okay, and this directly also brings us to the last part, and this is how to visualize data. So here again, I want to start with a bad example. A picture like this saying diagram of the measured data. What's all wrong about this? Okay, it is some curve, but we don't really know what is displayed here. So there are no axis labels here and there. We have this annoying gray background. There are no units here given for the numbers, and also the caption here is not really meaningful. It's a diagram, of course, everyone sees that's a diagram, and it is of some data. Okay, measured, could also be simulated. Again, a nice comic that I will not comment on. If you want to read it, just stop the video for a second, read it, think about this. I will continue. So what might be better, but still not really, is now we have later on just added here. This is should be some current, this is some frequency. Still, it does not look nice. Still, the units are missing. Still, we have this annoying gray background. And if I try to zoom in here a little bit, you can see that the quality of this figure is not really good. It's a raster graphic. It's compressed with a JPEG compression, which is a lossy compression, which creates this nasty compression artifacts, which makes this figure look fuzzy and blurry, and this is not good. So a better way, the same example improved, would look like this. So we have a clear figure, it has a nice plain background, we have clear big numbers, we have clear labels, we have the units given, and the data points that have really been measured are marked, and so then we have just linear interpolation in between. It's a vector graphic. Again, if I zoom in, you can see that there are no pixels here. I could infinitely zoom in, it would always look good. And we also have a meaningful caption that says, okay, this is the measured RMS current of the measured RMS value of some current. So this is a much better example. We also have a grid. that helps us to say, okay, where are these data points here, and so on. So in general, I would encourage you to use vector graphics if possible, especially for schematics and plots and charts and diagrams like this. For photographs, of course, you can use raster graphics. Yeah, raster graphics are consisting of single pixels. So for every pixel, it is stored what is the grayscale or what is the color of this pixel. But the problem with this raster graphics is if you scale them, if you enlarge them, pixels will grow larger and larger, and this will not look good. Instead, a vector graphic consists of basic geometric elements. So for this bus stop sign here, we have a yellow circle and a green ring and some green boxes or rectangles, and this creates the sign, and that's why we can arbitrarily scale it. Yeah? So if I zoom in here, pixels get very large. If I zoom in here, it will always look good, no matter on which screen you're looking at this. And that's why you should also favor, if possible, these vector graphics. And with respect to visualization, some more ways to know your audience. Don't put tables full of numbers on slides. It's very confusing for people, especially with a non-scientific and non-technical and non-engineering background, to look at large pile of large tables full of numbers. Sometimes it's necessary to do this, but then you should highlight some stuff and say, hey, I put a red circle around some number to show that here, this number, this is important because we improved this, or this is something that we enlarged or whatever. But still, then why you do not just focus on the single number and show this full table of other numbers around. Don't use raw computer output like this, with a strange number format. So what does this here mean, and what does the three stars here mean? And it's also very confusing. Don't use number format like this. Also, don't use too many digits if they are not really important. Yeah, so this would be just 5.34 times 10 to the power of minus 2, for example. And don't directly copy plots from your paper or report, because then the font will usually be too small. If you take a plot or schematic directly from your paper, where you have just 10 point or 8 point or 12 point font size, and if you put this on a presentation and show it on a large screen, then usually the font is too small, and just the people sitting in the very first row will have no problems in reading your numbers, and everyone else will have. And if you use figures from third parties, from other researchers, from other persons, cite the sources, give the sources. I would suggest to always give the source directly on this, on the corresponding slide, just like I did for the comics, for example, of Randall Munroe. Okay, so this concludes my talk. To give a little summary, practice, practice, practice. Do a lot of presentations. Try to give many talks, because this will improve your knowledge and your experience in doing so. It will also help to go to lots of conferences, to attend lots of seminars where other people will give presentations, because also there you can learn a little bit what makes a good presentation, what makes a bad presentation. You should also know your technical equipment. You should know how to connect the projector. You should know how to change from one slide to the next slide, and so on and so on. And again, easier said than done, don't be nervous. Maybe don't drink too much coffee before your talk. Drink just plain water. There are lots of tips. I will not give any further tips on how to be less nervous, but this is also something that you can practice a little bit. And of course, it's totally natural and totally normal to be a little nervous before some important presentation. And I said, look to other good presentations, learn from them. And I think a very, very good presentation where you can learn a lot from, also for engineering presentations, or technical presentations is this presentation here from Steve Jobs when he introduces the iPhone in 2007. So with this, I would like to conclude my talk. Thanks for your attention. If you have any questions, just leave them in the comments here below this video, and I will be happy to come back to you and answer your question. Thank you.